Now, from Wichita's most listened to sports radio, 97.5 and 1240 KFH, this is Sports Daily with Jacob Albracht and Tommy Castor.
Welcome in, everybody. It's a Friday edition, a jam-packed Friday edition, a bit abbreviated. We'll be with you until about 10:45 ahead of a Shocker baseball broadcast, but we are happy to be with you on this Good Friday. Sports Daily rolling forward. We're into baseball season now. We're through one half of the Sweet 16. We've got a great conversation, we hope, coming with Wichita State men's basketball coach Paul Mills, Wichita State athletic director Kevin Saul. That'll be coming at the top of the next hour. Shocker fans, be sure and tune in for that. Looking to really get a grasp of where things stand right now with the roster, what could be coming, what work is being done in the NIL space, all kinds of good stuff coming there. Looking forward to that coming again, top of the next hour. Jacob Albracht here alongside Tommy Castor, Jad Chambers producing. We'll look at some of the bets tonight for the second half of that Sweet 16 action. Glad to be here, but Tommy, opening day in the books, not great for the Royals. You get your Braves in today. The Rangers get a nice walk-off. I won't bore anybody with that, but that was pretty exciting last night. But, you know, the Royals get an opening day, doesn't go their way, but it's a happy opening day in general terms. Cole Reagans was fine. They didn't do much against Minnesota, and Pablo Lopez, I suppose you could call their ace, and you just kind of wash your hands of it and move on to the next one.
Yeah, it was one of those opening days, and of course you had the Sweet 16 that I thought about you last night because I knew that weird. You had your multiple TVs going with the Sweet 16 games and the Rangers playing in the night game on ESPN and all of that. When it relates to the Royals, yeah, I mean, I do think that it is too soon at this point to overreact to an opening day loss. You would have liked to start off the season, of course, at home at the K. It looked like a pretty good crowd at Kauffman Stadium. You can definitely tell the excitement is at a higher level than it's been in years past. You would have liked to come away with a win. Absolutely. You know, that's absolutely the case. But at the same time, it's one game out of 162. I'm sure we'll have this conversation multiple different times, you know, throughout the season about where we feel like the Royals stand right now. But, you know, it's not a great start to the year, but there's a lot of baseball to go.
A lot of baseball to go. And not today, by the way. The Royals are one of the teams that gets that weird, like, second day off thing, gives you a chance in case you have a rain out, is why baseball does that. I thought it was fine. I thought Cole Reagans was fine. You know, a little too much traffic, but he made it through six innings regardless. He struck out nine guys in six innings. I think you're happy with that there. Just not quite enough offense against Pablo Lopez. And it started nice with Michael Garcia, who, if the Royals are as good as we hope they could be, he's going to be a big reason that they are. His development, he's one of the young guys I think that you can really look to, along with, you know, obviously Bobby Witt Jr. is there, and you hope Vinny Pascantino's there, and you hope Salvi comes back. Michael Garcia is going to be a big part of that, I think, if the Royals are any good this year. So good to see him get off to a hot start. But, you know, it's fine. It's not that big a deal. Reagans look good. To me, that's all that mattered. Like, can Reagans carry, of everything that happened yesterday, as we look to this season, it's like, can Reagans continue to develop and be that guy? One game in, it was pretty good.
Yeah, it was fine. Yeah, I think that with Reagans, the biggest question is going to be, is he going to be able to be the ace of this rotation? You know, they gave him the ball on opening day. That tells you a lot. Tells you a lot about what the Royals organization and what Matt Quatrero thinks about Cole Reagans, and not only what he could be, but what he currently is. He was a revelation last season when he came over in that trade. You know, that there's no doubt about that. He was one of the few bright spots for Kansas City last year when he joined the organization. They think very highly of him. Otherwise, they wouldn't have given him the ball on opening day. Can he be the ace? Can he be the workhorse of this rotation? There's no doubt about it. There's more talent in that rotation than there's been in the last several years. I mean, probably 6 or 7 years from top to bottom with Michael Wacha and Seth Lugo and Brady Singer and others. But is Cole Reagan the guy? I think he was for sure the guy last year because they didn't have any other choice. And he was the only one who raised his hand, you know, when the time came. Can he continue that this season?
Yeah, that'll be, I mean, it's as important as anything that happens this Royals season. You know, it outside of winning games, of course, like his development, they've got to have some pitching that's young and controllable, and he's a good reason for that. You know, elsewhere across the baseball world, and we'll spend just a second with it here before we talk a little hoops, because we got a busy second hour coming for you. It's good to have baseball back, man. It's great. The Rangers and the Cubs gave us a great prime time. And I know everyone was watching March Madness. Probably not a lot of people were watching baseball, but it was a walk-off win in extra innings. There was a controversial call at the end of the game. Nice way to just sort of ease right on into the baseball season.
Yeah, you get slapped in the face with a controversial play on opening night.
It was pretty bad.
It is what it is.
It was pretty bad. I don't know if you saw it. It was bad. Yeah. There was a foul ball that wasn't called a foul ball, and it was the go-ahead run. It didn't matter. They won the game anyway. But the thing probably that stood out to me more than anything else that I saw yesterday was that as long as Shohei Ohtani's on the field, the top of that Dodgers lineup is stupid. It's ridiculous with Betts, Freeman, and Ohtani. Like, the thought of getting those three guys out, it's like, I remember the Astros in the playoffs last year. And in that, you know, they ultimately lost, of course. But in the middle of it, it was like, God, how do you just get through this lineup time and time again? The Dodgers is like that on steroids. Their lineup is ridiculous. Those three guys together, you're basically talking about, you know, you can, obviously, Ronald Acuna and what he did last year, but well, let's call it three out of the top five MVP candidates every year for the last, 5 years are sitting at the top of that lineup. It's ridiculous.
I read a stat last night that it's the first time in Major League Baseball history that you've got three players who finished in the top three of MVP voting the year before that start off a lineup 1-2-3, because Shohei Ohtani was the runaway favorite in the American League last year. And then Betts and Freeman were 2 and 3 in the National League behind Ronald Acuna. Now you've got all three of them in the same lineup going 1-2-3. That's daunting. That is absolutely daunting. I don't care if you are an ace. I don't care if you're the best pitcher on the planet. If you're Nolan Ryan, for God's sakes, doesn't matter to me. You're going to have a hard time facing Ohtani, Betts, and Freeman back to back to back. And there are so many different ways that the Dodgers can attack that, you know, and there's so many different ways that, you know, you've got the other players, and it's not like the rest of the lineup is slouches either, right? Like, they've got a pretty solid lineup from top to bottom. And so it's dangerous. It's that arms race in Major League Baseball. And that's a big reason why I know that my Braves have been picked as the consensus favorite to win a World Series this year. I'm not going to bet money on that. And it's solely because of what the Dodgers have at the top of their lineup.
Well, the Dodgers are still the odds on favorite. Maybe more people are picking the Braves, right? But I don't, you know, their mix of going and buying all the players, but also developing all the best players is something I'm not sure that we have seen. You know, usually it's one or the other, right? Like, the Rays always develop all the best players. The Yankees always buy all the best players. We never really had this mix like this, because they do. They just have all these great prospects coming up constantly. How many World Series has that won them, though?
That's the beauty of baseball.
Yeah, that's the beauty of baseball. They're going to win a boatload of regular season games. Beating them in the regular season will always feel good, right?
Yeah, and don't forget.
Doesn't mean anything once you get to the playoffs.
Don't forget, they also added Tyler Glasnow, the Dodgers did this year. And, you know, of course, one of the best pitchers in Major League Baseball goes to L.A. and bolsters that rotation, which, you know, I think that the rotation that the Dodgers have trotted out for the last several years, it hasn't changed a whole lot from top to bottom. Like, you think of the mainstays like Kershaw and Buehler and Julio Urias and all you know, these pitchers that they've had for quite a while. Then they go out and they bolster it, and they bring in Glasnow. And with what he did with Tampa Bay over the course of his career there, again, it just from top to bottom, it just makes that franchise so good. And it's interesting to me, like, you know, they start off the season playing the Cardinals, and the Cardinals, you know, for the last 20 years or 25 years have consistently always been good. They've consistently always been a playoff team. And it was night and day different from the way that, you know, the talent performed for the Dodgers on opening day versus the talent that the Cardinals have and guys like Nolan Arenado and Paul Goldschmidt and, you know, others. So it's just what I agree with you when you said that what the Dodgers are doing right now, it's kind of head and shoulders above basically anybody else in Major League Baseball as far as that combination of acquiring the top tier talent, but then also developing also what they've got.
It'll be fun, and it'll be fun to watch them play because they've got the star power. It'll be fun to beat them if you're playing against them. They'll become must-see TV. It's good for baseball. I know it drives people crazy, but it's good for baseball, I think, to have that sort of juggernaut in there, because if the Dodgers rolled into Kansas City, Kaufman's going to sell out.
People are going to show
like
up.
It's, you know, and I think that traveling road show is a good thing. Yep. It doesn't bother me like it bothers a lot of people. Is it fair? No. But it is the sport that we operate in, and the good thing about it is they don't win all the World Series. You know, you put together these kind of juggernauts in the NBA, and they win championships all the time.
Right.
Right? The Dodgers aren't doing that when it counts the most, and that adds to the drama of it. But that did stand out yesterday, as that was one of the games on national television. I'm just like, holy cow.
Meanwhile, you know who I feel bad for, and I've always kind of felt bad for him a little bit, is Mike Trout. Yeah, he hits a home run opening day for the Angels, and the Angels lose 11-3. And, you know, that's the way. I mean, I know it was even that way with Ohtani there, and, you know, just they kind of had a bunch of stars for a while. I've just had this feeling that Mike Trout is going to go down as one of the best baseball players of all time, and he's never going to have won anything. And it's just that's part of that. It happens occasionally, and I feel bad for the guy. It didn't work with when, you know, they had Ohtani and others, and, you know, here we are. He's still with that team, still with the franchise. You and I both have a ton of respect for Ron Washington, you know, with what he's done with our respective teams over the years. He's with the Angels now. I just don't see that happening for him, unfortunately.
Yeah, I don't know. I think they'll probably be a little bit better than we expect. However, they play in one of the best divisions of baseball, mm-hmm. So I don't know what it's going to mean. That's it. That's what really stood out to me in baseball yesterday. I'm just glad it's back. I'm really glad it's back. And I'm glad we have a chance to talk about it every day. Again, it's a day off, right? From baseball today for the Royals. It is a day off for the Royals, isn't it? Do they get a game today?
No, they're off today. Yeah, they're off today.
It's I get it. The Rangers are too. That always bugs me. Like, it kills your momentum to get started, but I get it because you had lots of teams that had to cancel yesterday that get today to play. So we'll follow that. You'll have them all weekend long. Looking forward to it with the Royals all season long here on KFH. Let's take a break here. We're going to come back and we'll dig into this Sweet 16 from last night, and then we'll look ahead to the Sweet 16 tonight. Don't forget, we've got Wichita State men's basketball coach Paul Mills, Kevin Saul, athletic director, joining us at the top of the next hour. A lot to get to through with those two gentlemen as we look ahead to a very important Shocker basketball offseason. That's all coming for you on Sports Daily. right, welcome back in, everybody. Sports Daily here on KFH. Glad to be with you on this Friday edition. Good Friday. March Madness continues, Tommy. We had the men's Sweet 16 first half of it last night. Arizona is out, so your bracket is done. That was one leg of a parlay I did. We talked about that yesterday. Clemson continues that run. Look, teams like Clemson are dangerous, man, in the tournament. That's what makes the tournament fun. They got a chip on their shoulder. They got that swag right now. UConn, we expect them to win. We didn't know if we liked the number. It turns out it was not even close. It was close at halftime, and then UConn just flexed on. That's what kind of what they do, and they wear people down. The other two games were fantastic, though. Really, and the Clemson-Arizona game was fine, but Alabama-North Carolina was a thriller. You know, it was funny. I liked the under in that game, Tommy. I saw the first half, and they got to 100, and I was like, this is toast. Yeah,
they were scoring a ton in the first half.
And then they almost hit the under.
Yeah.
In that second half, it really slowed down and bogged down, and they still did. It went over. It didn't matter because, you know, I had it with Clemson in that parlay. The only solo bet I did make is the one that hit. I took Illinois on that money line. That one I took by itself, so that was a nice win last night. Even though I hate it for Iowa State, Illinois is, to me, like, they've also got that swag like Clemson, but I think they're better. And so now they get UConn, and you look at it, and well, I don't know. Are we all Illinois fans, strangely now? Like, has UConn evolved into this thing you want to see beaten badly? They have for me. I want them to lose badly.
They haven't for me. They really haven't. I know a lot of people do not like Dan Hurley. And as the tournament has gone on,
it has started, less to do with him.
They've started to, like, he's become a villain, I think, for a lot of people.
I love that.
It's fun. I've always enjoyed Dan Hurley. I've always enjoyed Bobby Hurley. I've always enjoyed the Hurley brothers in general. I have this thought in my mind that UConn is going to absolutely wipe the floor with Illinois. And it is not a knock on Illinois. It's not a knock on Brad Underwood. Terrence Shannon is a phenomenal player. They have a ton of veterans on that Illinois team, and they flexed last night against Iowa State. It was a, you know, pretty early, like, first round knockout kind of thing that Illinois did to Iowa State. And when that happened, I'm like, oh, okay, well, maybe I've been underestimating Illinois throughout this entire process. That being said, though, UConn is phenomenal. And it's not so just good. The fact that they're winning games, it's the margin in which they are winning games. And you can even go back all the way to the tournament last year to look at the margin of victory in all of their NCAA tournament games. I think the margin is like they haven't won by less than 15 points going back to last season's tournament. And I know eventually, I mean, in the game of basketball, things do level out and you never know. But man, like, just they're rolling over the competition. And I know that the competition will get tougher. It always does as you move forward. And one of the knocks, I think, on UConn a year ago was, you know, and I think some people maybe discounted their national championship win because of the opponent they played in the national championship game. Nothing against San Diego State, but, you know, you're not talking about one of the blue bloods or one of the top teams in America kind of thing. This year, it's different, and they're going to be playing chalky games for the rest of the way. I have a hard time seeing anybody stopping them. I think they're going to roll right over Illinois.
They're 8.5-point favorites in the Elite Eight game against Illinois. The entire planet is about to bet UConn. Everybody's sure. Going to bet UConn. You know, the interesting thing about, we loved that region and loved because it was just insanely difficult seeming. But man, if you look at who they've actually had to play, they missed the dangerous Auburn team. They missed the dangerous FAU team. They're going to miss Iowa State. They almost have had good fortune again in who
they have.
Now, Illinois is my champion.
Sure.
So I'm not saying like Illinois, but it hasn't been as difficult up to this point as we thought it might be. It would have been far different had they opened with FAU, had they opened and then played Auburn.
But I still think, and maybe I'm being a UConn apologist here, but I still think if they find their way, and I think they will, out of this region to be the representative from that region, I don't think that you can knock them for the draw that they got within as the tournament played out, because at the very beginning, we're like, yeah, this is the most difficult region in the entire tournament. And I think that it played out that way, even though, I mean, of course, you've got Auburn falling in the first round and FAU falling, you know, all of that. But I still think that, you know, when you look back on it, if they can get out of this region as, you know, the Final Four team from there, regardless of who they played in that region, I think you can still say it was the most difficult region in the entire tournament.
Yeah, and they're either, if they beat Illinois, they're either going to play a 6 or a 4 in the Final Four. They may not play a 1.
Yeah.
They may not play a 2, or that, you know, so it is, and it's not UConn's fault.
No.
And it's not like they're not beating everybody by a million, but it is interesting when you think about it. Like, they could still have a path that seems relatively advantageous. Now, those teams have to win to get there. But if Clemson beats Alabama, and it's like, oh, well, they get Clemson in the Final Four. You know what I mean? It's like, okay.
Hey, this tournament is rife with teams that have high expectations vomiting all over themselves. Like, that's what it happens every single year.
Sure.
In varying levels. And what makes UConn stand out is they have not done that. They haven't even been challenged. There hasn't even been a situation where we've watched them and we've been like, oh, there might be a vulnerability there that somebody can exploit. There isn't. And so that's what makes it. It'd be different if they were squeaking out games. It'd be different if they were falling down early and, you know, having big comebacks to get their way, you know, to the next round. None of that's happening. They're just handily beating teams from top to bottom, from start to finish for 40 minutes, and it's been consistent. And that's what makes them the most dangerous team in the tournament left.
Yeah, it's they were the most dangerous team coming in. It's just hard to imagine doing it twice with everything we know about the men's basketball tournament and how wild and crazy it is. And if they do it, all the credit in the world to them. I just don't want to see them do it. I'm ready to see them lose. And you know, UConn's not a team I necessarily, but as a kid, when they were, you know, when they would get there all the time, like, they've had enough success historically. I mean, you'd be hard pressed to find a better tournament team than them over the last long time. They just, even when they had bad years, they would just randomly like mix in a championship. Well, now they're at a totally different level. And so, they'll be one to watch as we make our way down. Again, Illinois is my champion. I think Illinois is awesome. So, you know, there's certainly a part of that that's trying to win brackets, right? But I think Illinois is as hot a team as there is. And, you know, that matchup seems interesting to me because Illinois got all the size and you've got, you know, players playing out of their minds yesterday. I mean, Illinois, if they hit some free throws, that probably isn't that tight, and that's against a team we all love. But Terrence Shannon Jr., I mean, he's getting shot out of a rocket right now. He looks faster than everybody on the floor. 29 points last night. We'll see. UConn, whoo boy, 30-point winners over San Diego State. Some interesting ones tonight. Marquette, Tommy, is a 7-point favorite against NC State. How about that line? Another team, sort of like Clemson, that is white hot. Boy, I'm not touching Marquette -7 on there. I guess I would probably take the points.
I'm going to take the points. 100% take
I don't
the
know.
Points.
I don't really have a thought on the over-under. I think for me, that's just I'll just take the +7 on that.
Marquette is a good basketball team. Don't get me wrong. And, you know, they've been talented. They've been successful. But they've stumbled at times. And I know a lot of it is the health of Tyler Kolick down the stretch. And it seems like, you know, he's full go and everything's good there. But that being said, I mean, you know, NC State, it's more about riding the hot hand. And outside of Clemson, I agree with you. I mean, I think NC State is the hottest team in the tournament remaining. I'd probably put Alabama in that category as well, as far as being a hot team. Really, NC State.
I mean, nobody's hotter than NC State.
Yeah, NC State has ridden this
5 days thing.
Yeah, and it went all the way back to the ACC tournament. Like, they haven't lost in weeks, and it's been a win or go home scenario for them for a number of weeks, and they just continue to win. So, I'm not going to touch Marquette with that because NC State has found a formula to keep winning and keep playing basketball. And will they win the game? I don't know, but I'm certainly not taking Marquette -7.
Gonzaga Purdue is the next one. Purdue is a 5-point favorite. I think I like Purdue here. You know, they've got experience now. They've handled themselves nicely in this tournament. Gonzaga has been in a situation where they're getting a lot of good shots and they're hitting them, something they, I don't, you know, that hasn't really been their bread and butter, but a lot of those hits on Kansas were defensive letdowns for Kansas. I didn't watch every second of their opening round game against McNeese State, but McNeese State isn't, you know, a team known for its just smothering defense. They're going to get a level of defense, I think, probably that they're not, that they haven't so far in the tournament. I think Purdue's good. I'm going to take Purdue, and I'm comfortable with the 5 points there. What do you think on this one?
Gonzaga impressed me a lot in the second half against Kansas. They impressed me the entire game. I thought that, you know, Gonzaga was not as dominant of a Gonzaga team that we've been used to seeing in years past. I think, obviously, the loss of Drew Timmy and, you know, all of that, him moving on and leaving the program, probably contributed to that quite a bit. But that being said, though, it's still Mark Few. And, you know, it's like there are only only some things that are consistent in life, guaranteed in life, death, taxes, and Mark Few at Gonzaga. And so I was impressed with them. I didn't have them going. I thought they were going to be upset in the first round, to be honest with you. And so with what they've been able to do, and they blew out McNeese State, they blew out Kansas. I think they're going to give Purdue a run for their money. I'm not sure there is a team in the tournament, and maybe not even just out of the Sweet 16 that, you know, that are remaining, but in the entire tournament going all the way back to Selection Sunday, with more pressure on their shoulders than Purdue, with the expectations that Purdue has and with the fact that they have been eliminated early, and that's become the narrative over the last couple of years for the Boilermakers and Matt Painter in general, is that they can't get it done in the tournament, that they've got these high expectations, incredible talent with guys like Zach Edey and others, and they've just not been able to get it done, and they get bounced early. There's a lot of pressure on their shoulders to bust that narrative. I'm not sure that they're there quite yet. I think they need to get into the Elite Eight and maybe even the Final Four to bust that narrative up. Gonzaga is a tough team, and I think that it's not a great matchup for Purdue, because I think Gonzaga can shoot the ball lights out. So I'm going to actually take the points, I think. I think it's going to be a close game. I do think Purdue pulls it out, but I'm going to take the points.
I just think Gonzaga is going to, they're not going to get the open looks they got against Kansas. Kansas couldn't figure out how to defend a pick and roll. I don't think that's going to happen with Purdue. Purdue, they're not the best defensive team in the country, but they're pretty good. And I just look at some of their, the hardest thing to figure about Purdue is if they have any sort of, you know, like let up, which every team in the country does, right? They only, what did they lose? 4 games all season. So it hadn't happened very often. They went on the road and beat Illinois. They went on the road and beat Wisconsin in the regular season. Like, they have some really good wins. And so I think it is a little bit different than it has been in years past for them. I think this is, you know, they seem less ripe to me for getting upset the way they have in years past. Now, Gonzaga may come out and stylistically just beat them in a really competitive game. I don't think it's going to be because Purdue poops their pants this time. I think it may be just because Gonzaga plays better. You know what I mean? Does that make any sense? So because they have, you know, because they're there, and because I don't think that's going to bite them now at this point this year, I think they'll be okay. It will be interesting stylistically, though, because Gonzaga had the bigs of Kansas sort of just running around with their heads cut off, trying to defend that pick and roll offense. I don't know enough about the rest of Purdue's roster, quite frankly. But you know, if they do the same sort of thing with Edey, I doubt Purdue's got Edey playing at the top of the key like Kansas had their bigs.
Right.
So it probably is not even worth trying to compare. The other games today, Duke and Houston should be fantastic tonight. Houston coming off that just insane overtime win over Texas A&M, where they let A&M back in the game, had a lot of their players foul out, and then still found a way to win. I actually think that's good for Houston. I think Houston's just a really, really good team. Hard to ignore what Duke has done, but I'm going to lay those points, and I'm going to take the Cougs, who I think over the course of the year have been the best team in college basketball. Oh, you know, as far as over the course of a regular season, I'm going to lean back on that just a little bit. All that experience, the fact that I think they have one of the best coaches in the country, within a game, I'm going to take the Cougs here, and I think I'm just fine with the 4 points.
Isn't it funny that it's Houston's first year in the Big 12, and they're the only Big 12 team remaining in the NCAA tournament? Right. And now, you know, if you, and this is the way that I am, and I'm sure a lot of people are like this too, if your team is out, then you start rooting for the conference. And I'm a Big 12 guy.
I do always have been, sure, right? Yeah.
And so in the, you know, their first year in the conference, now I'm fully behind Houston. Like, let's go win a national championship. And I never thought that I would be that way with a program like Houston, but here we are. They have completely separated themselves from the rest of the conference, and they're the last man standing in the Big 12. And I think that, I mean, I remember there being questions when they joined the Big 12 about, well, will their style of play translate from the American to the Big 12? And, you know, they're going to get a good taste of reality once they jump into this conference, and it's where the big boys play. And all of a sudden, here they are. They're the only representative left.
By the way, nobody in Wichita thought that, because we saw them play in the American. For sure. It's like, oh, no, they'll translate.
They'll be okay.
Just fine.
They'll be okay.
Everybody else around the league, yes, probably thought that. We're like, guys, you have no idea what you're about to get yourselves into with Houston. They are going to suffocate you.
I'm with you. I'm going to take Houston. I'm going to lay the points. I don't think Duke. I think that they have played better than what I expected throughout the tournament. They were another team that I had.
Talented, yeah,
they,
obviously.
They were another a team that I had pegged for an early round exit, an early round upset, just because. Yeah, they do have a significant amount of talent. Obviously, they do. I just wasn't sure that they were, you know, going to be ready to make a deep run in March. Here they are, but I do think that Houston will win. I'm going to lay the points. I actually think Houston probably wins by double digits.
Oh, whoa. No, Duke's too talented for me to write.
When I say double, I mean 10. I think that Houston wins by 10. I'm not saying they blow them out, Duke, but I think it'll be Duke, a 10-point win.
The Duke is a team. They're weird. Teams like Duke, not specifically them, but teams like them, they get in and they're at this point and they're sort of name brand, and you know that talent to talent, they've got as much, like, I don't know, NBA talent, however you want to define it, as anybody. These are weird teams that, like, go to title games. I mean, we've seen UConn did it last year. We see it all the time in the tournament. I feel like that there's these just teams that are loaded. A lot of the time it's young players sort of just hit their stride as the season goes along, and all of a sudden they're right there, right?
Yeah, keep in mind with Duke, and I don't know how much of a factor this will play, but they do have a little bit of injury issues. You know, Jalen Blake's had that scary fall in the game last week. I think he's okay. I think he's been practicing all week long, but that was one. And then Jeremy Roach dislocated his finger. And, you know, he averages like 15 points a game. So he should be okay, I think, but it is something the Bears watching. And, you know, that may end up playing a role in the game tonight.
It maybe is my favorite game of today, I think. Creighton, Tennessee is another one that I think all these games today should be fun, as they typically are in the Sweet 16. The nightcap tonight, Creighton and Tennessee. Creighton's also in my Final Four. This is a really interesting one as well. It feels like an eternity since Creighton had that double overtime game to get to this point.
Yep.
Rick Barnes. I don't have a problem rooting for Rick Barnes and Tennessee at this point. And I didn't used to like Tennessee at all, but I like Rick Barnes. Goes back to the old Big 12 allegiance you were talking about. But real quick, as an aside, speaking of the Big 12, has it dawned on you? Because it hadn't really dawned on me yet. Arizona, like next year.
Yeah.
Arizona's going to be in the Big 12.
Big 12 team.
Wild. Anyway, so I've got Creighton in, so I'm definitely going to take the points. I'll just make that a money line bet tonight, probably. But that's a coin flip to me. Just like Illinois Iowa State last night, total coin flip.
I've got nothing against Tennessee at all. Got a lot of respect for Rick Barnes, just like you. I want to see Creighton be able to make a run. I want to see. I mean, it seems like cool. We talked about it before. They always are there. Greg McDermott's consistent. But they never really get over that hump and get all the way. I want to see them do that tonight.
Yeah, I do too. I do too. It'll be. There are some good ones. My guess is this, Tommy. I think all four of these games are going to end up being competitive, and good, and entertaining, and fun to watch. All right, we're going to take a quick break. We'll come back. We will wrap up hour number one before we get to Kevin Saul and Paul Mills on the show today. Shocker Baseball on KFH is all season long. You can stay tuned. We'll have a little pregame for you as we hand it off to Mike Kennedy at 10:45 as the Shockers get ready to host Rice. You can take it with you for free on the Odyssey app. We'll come right back. More Sports Daily right after this. All right, welcome back in, everybody. Sports Daily wrapping up the first hour here. Coming up top of the next hour, we will have Wichita State Athletic Director Kevin Saul, Wichita State Edmonds basketball coach Paul Mills joining the show. Until then, let's give something away, Jad. Let's give away some HTO tea and coffee. You can get a free iced tea, which is good for Wichita in the east or west side or in Derby. More than 25 flavors to choose from there. We'll also get you a free coffee card, which is good in Derby or in East Wichita, now featuring Free Rain coffee. So you can get your hands on those. First caller right now to the KFH hotline at 869-1240. Jad will get us a winner as we move forward. We look ahead and you've got all kinds of good stuff. You've got Rice with Wichita State continuing that series. Again, the programming note, we will hand that off to Mike Kennedy coming up at 1045 today. You've got all kinds of action. The Royals continue tomorrow as we head into the Easter weekend. It should be a lot of fun. So, Tommy, we look ahead to March Madness as we try to predict the future, right? Because we will not be on the air until we're, know in determining the final four of the teams nobody's talking about to get there. Is there a more overlooked team? Let me ask it to you this way. And this comes into this NC State Marquette game tonight. I feel like those are two of the teams that would surprise people. But why would Marquette surprise us? Why should Marquette surprise us, right? They're a two seed. They're healthy, which was their big question coming into the year. They have a road win at Illinois. They beat Kansas back when Kansas was really good. They lost to Purdue by 3, right? They have a win over Texas. They've beaten Creighton this year. UConn they struggled with. Marquette's probably, I think, the most fairly overlooked team in the tournament, right? Am I missing something or are we underselling Marquette's potential here?
I think they're overlooked to an extent. I don't think they're the most overlooked team in the tournament. I think the most overlooked team in the tournament is Tennessee. I feel like what Rick Barnes has done and, just what they did in the SEC this year and all of that, you don't hear much about Tennessee. And I honestly forgot that, number one, they had even, they were in the tournament, what seed they were, and that they made the Sweet 16. And it's because you've got all the other storylines of the dominant teams like the UConns and the Houstons and the Purdues. And then you've got the NC States and the Clemsons who are hot right now. You don't think about a team like Tennessee. And that's what Rick Barnes has never been a flashy kind of coach. He's not really a lot of times a headline grabbing coach. So you don't hear a lot from him like you hear from Dan Hurley and, other guys like that. Shaka Smart is pretty verbal and out there, in front of things. Bruce Pearl at Auburn. Like there are a lot of Calipari, a lot of examples of, really forward facing coaches, and Rick Barnes isn't one of them. And so I think that, knowing that, there is, I think, a little bit of a situation where they do get overlooked at times.
It's funny. And I think you're correct, but I feel like we're talking more about like NC State than I'll agree. Those two seeds, sure. Right? Like, and they've absolutely earned them. They each have really big wins this year. My problem with them, I think, is I don't see a scenario where I see either of those teams, let's say, beating UConn or Houston. And I think that's where I have some pause. UConn's done that to us, though. Right now, it's like, can anybody beat UConn? And they're probably we should be doing that with Houston, I think, except Houston had that scare against A&M. It's just that's the way UConn feels. That's why I want them to lose so badly. Right. That's why I want them to lose, is because it feels right now like that nobody can beat them. And so I just want to see it for that reason, right, as much as anything else. Like it does. They are taking away from what has been incredible. See, I mean, Houston was the top 10 and Houston earned that. Right. The things that Houston did playing in the league that they played in this year are remarkable, more impressive than what UConn did in the regular season, I think. Right. And so. And it's probably pretty comparable, right? Like Kansas beat each of them once in the season. So maybe they're more comparable than we think, but it is the UConn effect, I think. And yeah, I don't, we're both taking the points against Marquette. We're both taking Creighton. So we're guilty of it. I mean, we're just as guilty as anybody else.
For sure.
I can't wait for it. The Sweet 16 is fun. Those games last night were, you know, there was one that wasn't fun. The rest of them were great. And I hope we get that again tonight. Other things happening here before we get to a break and then have our Shocker men's basketball talk. I want to remind you that mornings at KFH, staff enjoys a great cup of Prairie Fire coffee, getting us ready for the weekend. We have, of course, baseball and softball happening with Wichita State right now. Both of those programs are in conference play. We will, you know, we'll sort of make that shift. We'll sort of make that shift soon, like in a couple of weeks, probably. You had Shocker baseball get the opener against Rice. Shocker softball, a little bit disappointing of an outcome yesterday. They fall to Charlotte, but it is almost that season as well. So Shocker fans, I know we will get into that, but it's still basketball season, and that's what we're going to do next. We're going to get to the latest with Shocker men's basketball. Head coach Paul Mills is going to join us. Kevin Saul is going to join us. And we're going to talk about all things, what the roster looks like right now, what the expectations are to add to the roster. Do we think that's it? Is this the group and there's four spots to fill, or is there any fear still that players might leave? We'll get to the bottom of all of it. Kevin Saul, Paul Mills, join us next on Sports Daily.
Laugh Out Loud Mornings with Bob and Tom on 97.5 and 1240 KFH, Wichita's most listened to sports radio. Always live on the free Odyssey app.
Oh, honey, it's our favorite leaf filter trusted pro, Matt. Matt, come in.
Hi, Mrs. Sparks. You wanted me to stop by? Is everything okay with your leaf filter gutter protection system?
Okay. Of course, silly. We wanted you to stop by for dinner as our way of thanking you.
Yes, to thank you for that free gutter inspection, the free estimate, and what was the other thing?
That lifetime guarantee.
Well, Mr. and Mrs. Sparks, those are just leaf filter's policies. Everyone who calls leaf filter gets a trusted pro to come out for a free gutter inspection and estimate. And every leaf filter installation comes with a lifetime guarantee.
So it's not just us?
No, sir. We don't want anyone to worry about clogged gutters ever again.
You mean everyone gets this level of service?
Everyone. They just need to visit leaffilter.com/CBS to schedule their free inspection.
Okay, but you must be starving. You work so hard.
Ready to love your gutter protection as much as we do? Visit leaffilter.com/CBS and get up to 30% off today.
See representative for warranty details. Promotion is 20% off plus a 10% senior or military discount. One discount per household.
KFH and the Bob and Tom Morning Show welcome Jeff Dunham as he performs at Intrust Bank Arena Thursday, April 25th on his new, still not canceled, national tour.
All right, did you enjoy being in New York City? Oh, I love New York City. Good. Yeah, that was great. We'd do shows in Manhattan. About midnight, we'd get back to the hotel. 1 a.m., I'd lay my head on the pillow and listen to the sounds of the city. Woo-hoo! I love them!
We'd like to send you to the show with premium seats from KFH. Just listen mornings all next week to Bob and Tom on KFH. When you hear the cue to call, be caller 5 and you'll win. It's that easy. Jeff Dunham, listen mornings and win with Bob and Tom on KFH.
Beginning our morning under mostly cloudy skies and temperatures currently in the mid-60s.
Weather brought to you by Robert Half.
9 out of 10 hiring managers are having difficulty hiring today. Robert Half is here to help. At Robert Half, we know talent. Visit roberthalf.com today.
Say goodbye to busted brackets because FanDuel lets you bet on every single game of the tournament. Whether you're betting on a big upset or a one seed, it's time to go dancing on America's number one sports book. Right now, new customers get $200 in bonus bets if your first $5 bet wins. Now, in those later rounds, be sure to look out for some upsets, but this is usually when the higher seeds break apart. That's $200 to use on point spreads, money lines. You can even pick who's going to win it all. Just visit FanDuel.com/loots and bet on college hoops until they cut down the nets. That's FanDuel.com/LUTZ. 21 plus and present in Kansas. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued as non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. FanDuel is offering online sports wagering in Kansas under an agreement with Kansas Star Casino, LLC. Gambling problem? Getting help is your best bet. Call 1-800-522-4700 or visit ksgamblinghelp.com.
Go Hog Wild Pit Barbecue. Hog Wild, get some for you. Lean beef, pork, and ribs. Your family will love. Pour on the spices and sauces. because you can't get enough of.
Order your Hogwild slow-smoked Easter ham today. Award-winning barbecue, so you're sure to have the perfect ham as the centerpiece of your Easter meal that everyone will enjoy. Hogwild selects only the highest quality hams, then slow-smokes them for hours until they're tender and juicy. A Hogwild 100% boneless slow-smoked ham is approximately £4 and $50. Order online at GoHogWild.com. Place your order soon as quantities are limited. Hogwild Pit Barbecue, 6 locations in Wichita, also in Derby, El Dorado, Hutchinson, and Salina.
Go Hogwild Pit Barbecue. Hogwild, get some for you. But don't be late, we close at 8.
Baseball fans, support your hometown Shockers this spring. With new head coach Brian Green, the Shockers are playing an exciting brand of baseball, and new enhancements to the outfield experience on Coleman Hill at X Stadium have turned each game into a can't-miss event. Bring in a cooler filled with your own food and beverages out to Coleman Hill for a fun and cheap outing at the ballpark. Select alcoholic beverages are permitted. Restrictions apply, and fans must be 21 to drink. View upcoming games and grab your tickets today. Visit GoShockers.com/tickets or call 316-978-FANS.
When people have a craving to explore new and traditional Asian cuisines, they head to P.F. Chang's, where scratch-made dishes come from the 2,000-year-old tradition of wok cooking. P.F. Chang's wanted to explore new possibilities for their website. They turned to AmericanEagle.com. AmericanEagle.com re-architected P.F. Chang's website, integrating multiple third-party systems to create a unified digital experience. The results? Improved page speed and performance, personalized content based on users' location, intuitive online ordering, an increase in organic search visibility, and a 40% increase in new users. For scratch-made Asian cuisine, visit your local PF Chang's or go to pfchangs.com for website design, development, digital marketing, and hosting that produce efficiency, revenue, and results. Visit AmericanEagle.com. PF Chang's and AmericanEagle.com. Another example of the best businesses in the world. Turning to the best in the business for websites, go to AmericanEagle.com or call 877-WEB-NOW-1. That's 877-WEB-NOW-1.
The KFH Studios, powered by Devon James Injury Lawyers. Call 888-8888. That's 888-8888.
JUCO Women's Basketball, the 49th Annual National Junior College Tournament in Casper, Wyoming. We're into the quarterfinals now. The number one team, the Hutchinson Community College Lady Blue Dragons, taking on number 8 national seed, New Mexico Junior College today. Hutchinson, number one in the nation, undefeated with a record of 34-0. The national quarterfinals, JUCO Women's National Tournament today. We've lost one of the all-time greats up at KU in men's basketball. The big guy, 6'11", Walt Wesley, has died at the age of 79 from leukemia. Two-time consensus All-American in the mid-1960s. Averaged for his career 19 points a game, top 10 all-time in KU history. A number 6 overall pick by the Cincinnati Royals, played a decade in the NBA, held the Cleveland Cavaliers a single-game scoring record at 50 points until it was broken by a guy named LeBron James. Walt Wesley, the KU great, has passed at age 79.
Now, from Wichita's most listened to sports radio, 97.5 and 1240 KFH, this is Sports Daily with Jacob Albracht and Tommy Kester.
I'm going to Wichita.
Hey, Shocker fans, want the latest on Wichita State athletics? Let's go right to the source with Shocker AD Kevin Saul.
And we welcome you back in. Thank you for tuning in here on KFH. Thanks for watching on our video streams, Facebook, YouTube, and on X. And we do have Kevin Saul in alongside the men's head basketball coach at Wichita State, Paul Mills, as well. Gentlemen, glad to have you on today. Happy belated opening day of Major League Baseball. It's a great time of the college basketball season, a great time to talk Shocker basketball. Welcome in, and thanks for being here.
Thanks for having us, Jacob. Good to hear your voice. Hope you're doing well.
Yeah, it's a fun time of the sports year, and we're happy to have you guys in because we want to know what the latest with the Shockers is. So we'll just sort of try to roundtable this as best we can for the listeners. Coach, I want to start with you. The roster we've seen, you know, Colby Rogers and Kenny Poto and a couple of others out. Do you guys anticipate the group now that's there will be the group moving forward? And do we have it correct as 4 open spots with the freshmen coming in based on the losses to graduation and the transfer portal and what's coming back, or where did things stand right now for you guys just from a roster standpoint?
Yeah, I mean, one, that's great observation by you, but, you know, Bijan, Xavier, Harlan, Ronnie, I know Quincy has already announced, and then Joy and Giannis, the two freshmen. Those guys are in place. You know, one of the things that happens is as soon as the season is over and you really don't waste much time, it's done within a 24-hour period. Who's returning and who isn't, or who may want to, you know, explore other opportunities. And I know sometimes it gets to the public a little bit later, but you have to kind of have an idea about what your foundation is in order to formulate a plan moving forward. But yeah, you're accurate in that currently there are four open spots.
Coach, as you are putting together what this roster looks like moving forward and, you know, working on the transfer portal, and we know that you've got the incoming freshmen and all of that, as far as priorities, like what you're looking for from a skill set perspective, from ways to improve this team, make things better in year number two, what are the top priorities in as far as just an overall skill set and attributes that you're looking for in players?
Yeah, I mean, we definitely need to address some shooting deficiencies. I mean, if you look at it this past year, just from the free throw line, out of the 362 teams, we were 292 at being able to make free throws. And so, you know, we were 2-10 in what's considered the clutch record. Hey, with 5 minutes to go, you're plus or minus five. And we were 2-10. But if you look at it, a lot of that just came down to free throw ability. And then I think the other thing that we have to address is our turnover situation. I mean, we were 228th in the country at turning it over. And so you have to get the most out of your possessions from a shooting perspective. And so we do need some backcourt help. We'll address that. You're not going to address it via the high school route. You're going to address it via the transfer route. So you're out there looking. We need some help in the front court, but that is the focus, is making sure that we shore up our backcourt, really add shooting to our lineup, and then at the same time get some front court help in order to continue to be, you know, better defensively.
This is probably a question for both of you guys, and I'll let either of you kind of attack it. We've sort of looked at this the last, I don't know, week and change or however long it's been now, is, you know, Colby Rogers is off to probably a big time power program if we had to guess. That's not the first time that's happened at Wichita State. In recent years, we've seen that a lot where, you know, whether it's the leading scorer or the most high profile player looks for that opportunity. It has us wondering, and what are the things that you guys think need to happen the most to prevent that from happening consistently? Obviously, winning is going to help that. Obviously, the NIL space is going to help that. But where do things stand right now for Wichita State to be a place where great players want to finish their careers and not maybe go on to another place for other opportunities?
Yeah, that is a great question. You know, I've been fortunate that, you know, whether I was at Oral Roberts and we had a three-time AP All-American and Max Asemus, also had another All-American and Kevin O'Banner, all of those guys were able to graduate. And then both of them eventually moved on. Max, after I took the job here a year ago, wanted to get back closer to home for his family to see him play. But I think what you have to figure out is one, you have to win. Guys need to experience winning, but they also need to know that there's a path moving forward to accomplish whatever it is they're trying to accomplish. For a lot of these guys, it's trying to make the most out of their God-given abilities, and that means being a pro. And we've seen it, obviously, with Craig Porter, is the latest guy. But the good news here is that Shockers support and the support is heavy. So players want to be a part of this. Of the guys that have left, you don't fault, from my perspective, any of them. They never signed up for me. And as they go through it and they went through it their experience. They're looking for something more. But a lot of times you have to be able to ascertain, is this something where a person is going to be committed throughout their whole, they've got a history of it, of staying committed through this process. And so you kind of have an idea about what you're dealing with from a personality and a character standpoint. And you have to do a great job of vetting that stuff on the front end. And then once they get here, the experience needs to be enriching enough that the desire is, because of the experience, the desire is to stay.
Kevin, kind of following up on that a little bit from your perspective as athletic director, you know, knowing that in this new world of college athletics and with the transfer portal and all of that, we're dealing with NIL. That's been a major, major focus, not only at Wichita State, but universities around the country to make sure that they stay competitive in that landscape. So when we're talking about, you know, not only players like Colby Rogers or others that are leaving the program, maybe for NIL opportunities elsewhere. Number one, I guess, you know, in your mind as athletic director, how do you work through all of that to not only try to retain the current student athletes, but then also be an attractive landing spot for other players? And then maybe not even just in basketball, but sports in general, to come to Wichita State and continue their career with the Shockers.
Yeah, Tommy, I'm really glad you asked that. And I'll just jump into to one specific comment of coaches is creating an enriching and fulfilling developmental experience for our student athletes. I think we can run around trying to put out individual fires, or we can focus on the global picture and raise tides for all boats with our overall student athlete experience. And I'll take maybe a minute or two to explain, I think, some exciting results in terms of where we're headed with that within Shocker Athletics. So we do programmatic surveys of our student athletes and usually get a response rate anywhere between 75 and 85% each semester. So we've done three of these now. We've done fall of 22, spring of 23, and fall of 23. We compared aggregate scores for guys, 40 different questions that we ask. And those questions are centered around athletic department sport support in the areas of like strength and conditioning, academic support, athletic training, nutrition. We ask questions about the institution, specifically about the team, their culture, values, facilities, fan support, head coach, position coaches, all those things. And so the results of this have been really, really encouraging. So we've got 40 questions. The beauty of this survey is that it quantifies the student athlete's perception of their experience. And the even greater beauty of it is there's 100 Division I institutions that are asking the same questions, and 40 of those are Power 5 institutions. And so when I share with you that peer group of 100 Division I institutions, 40 of which are Power 5s, we are above our peer group average in 33 out of 40 categories on that student athlete survey. That's very encouraging. The other thing that survey allows us to do is to dive in depth into areas where we might be either under the national average or areas that may have slid from one semester to another. It allows us to ask specific questions of our student athletes and ultimately dial into an experience, as Paul mentioned, that's both enriching and fulfilling.
Wichita State Athletic Director Kevin Saul joining us, and Wichita Head Men's Basketball Coach Paul Mills. We really appreciate it. And Will mentioned that Kevin and Paul Sullentrup on the Roundhouse podcast, which you can find on the Odyssey app, goes in depth into the NIL space and some of the things happening. I guess at a bird's eye look then, Kevin, do you feel like the Shockers, financially speaking, this is, you know, a lot of this is a fundraising effort. Do you feel like Wichita State is where it needs to be in the support there to get players and do the things you guys need to do just on that base level of it? Or is that, you know, still, and I'm sure it's a work in progress, but I think you know what I mean. Are we in a good space right now this off season to get players in here?
We're certainly in a better space than we were in July of 21 or July of 22. And we're keenly focused, both Paul and I are, on building those resources. He and I are aligned that those resources are most impactful from a retention standpoint, maybe more so than a recruiting standpoint. Now, there is a cost of admission in the recruiting process, whether it's NIL, facilities, coaching staff, player development. There is a minimum standard there.
but we believe that the NIL dollars have much greater value on the retention side. So I would tell you we're in a much better place. I would tell you that our goal will be to surpass the American Athletic Conference average in terms of distributed NIL. And we have what we believe is a very, very realistic goal, Jacob and Tommy. We have over 110,000 living alumni at Wichita State University. And our goal is to recruit 5,000 Shocker alumni to get $500 a year. That's $42 a month. You can go on to wheatshotcollective.com and you can select the Silver Pass in the donate page. You can do $50 a month there. But what that does for us department-wide is about $2.5 million a year. And again, it's 5,000 people at basically $42 a month, $500 a year. And that helps us not only in men's basketball, but women's basketball, baseball, softball, volleyball, and some of our other Olympic sports. As we're into year three of NIL, we're starting to understand where our league average is, where our aspirational peer averages are in the NIL space. So the short answer is no, we're not there yet, Jacob, but we are working our way towards that. We've got some data that tells us where we need to be, and we're pushing that hard.
Coach, I want to go back to you and talk about the American Conference tournament for a second. From a momentum standpoint, how important was that for you and, you know, the way that you're building this program, being able to make that run in the conference tournament, you know, knock off a couple of teams that, you know, including Memphis. And, you know, we know that Memphis has had Wichita State's number over the last few years. Does that help you build for next season and moving forward? And then I guess kind of a follow-up on that, once you get done with that run in the conference tournament, and then we go into the offseason where there's a transfer portal and you've got a couple of players that are leaving, does that stunt that momentum at all? Or can you go ahead and plow forward regardless of who's leaving and who's coming into the program?
Yeah, one, it definitely helps. You know, I think anytime that you can win in March, I think that we preach a lot about here is about having a game for March. And that is why a lot of people are attracted to college basketball is because of what March Madness generates. I mean, outside of the World Cup, it's the second most watched sporting event in sports. And so to know that and to have a game for March and to be able to play well on a neutral floor. I know Rice we had just played, and then to be able to play Memphis, we had played them well there and didn't, came up 2 seconds short due to a David Jones bucket at the end. But to get that and then UAB, I think that game obviously was competitive for the first 35 minutes and then down the stretch. We just weren't able to make the plays, but all of those things help. I will tell you that from a transfer standpoint, you almost know this stuff 2 months before it ever happened. And so I don't think that it stunted any of the momentum. Our staff knew exactly and had an idea about what was going to happen and how it was going to play out. We moved forward. I can tell you that there were zero surprises. And so moving forward, I don't think any of that has stunted any of our momentum, any of our enthusiasm. We're excited about about upgrading the roster moving forward in anticipation of this fall.
That's really interesting, Coach, to me, because I to hear that, and I imagine this is the same in a lot. It made right when you said that, it made me laugh a little bit because there was a way out of context situation taken with Bill Self about saying, well, yeah, I've been thinking about that stuff for a while. If those conversations are allowed to happen, I didn't get any indication in watching Wichita State basketball at the end of the season that there wasn't a player out on the floor that was 100% committed to winning every game they were playing. And guess what?
Yeah,
we can all walk and chew gum. We can
give you that impression. What
I'm saying is we can walk and chew gum at the same time, right? Like you guys can have honest conversations and still be 100% invested in this season. I think that's awesome. I think that's really interesting and a credit to young people that you guys are giving them enough respect and appreciation to know that look, we can all, like, everybody's sort of in this together to some degree, right? Like, those guys played their tails off for you at the end of the season. That's incredible. That's awesome.
And I think, I mean, this isn't as difficult as we're making it out to be. I mean, if I'm around Jacob and Tommy for any particular time, I can identify whether or not you're happy or not. And it doesn't mean that you're not putting forth your best effort. And but you know, hey, at the end of this period, we're going to reevaluate how this all played out. But it doesn't mean that you're not putting your best foot forward and you're giving your quality effort, one, because it's a responsibility, but two, also because you enjoy what you're doing. And so I don't want to give this impression at all that, but at the same time, you can identify people who, man, you know what, I'm going to have some questions at the end that may lead to me doing something different. And you know what? You fully support that. You're fully behind your players that you guys need to do what is best for you. Whatever you believe is best for you and your family moving forward. And again, it isn't as if any of the guys that have decided to leave, and I want you to know that we fully support each of them and are happy for them and what they'll venture out to next. But there's some questions and things that they may be looking for that you may not be able to provide. And I'm not just talking about NIL. I'm talking about from a basketball standpoint. Somebody may want a bigger role. Somebody may want more shots. Somebody may want more opportunities at a position that they're not playing. And so it doesn't mean that they're not giving their best effort during that moment. But it also, you know, moving forward, you realize that there will be some questions that you may not be able to answer in a way that they're comforted by.
Kevin, I want to go back to you briefly and talk a little bit from an institutional point of view and really specifically about you and your role as athletic director. As everybody knows, and it's talked about all the time, the way that college athletics has evolved. And I think that, and correct me if I'm wrong here, but I would imagine that, you know, that means that roles change also. And so, you know, I'm sure some of the things that Coach Mills is doing now is different than what, you know, he was probably doing 5 years ago because of the world of NIL and the transfer portal and things like that. But I know that it definitely impacts your role as an athletic director. So from an organizational standpoint, as you have been with Wichita State now for a couple of years, and I know that it's been a top priority for you, you know, Kevin, to move this university forward and put the athletic department as a whole in a better position than it was before. What does that look like for you? And as you're entering into year three here in a couple of months, how do things shift from years one and two to years three and beyond for you?
I think thanks for asking that question. I think it really boils down to what our mission is. And our mission is really simple. It's to develop young people and programs. And we do that through first-class service to our student athletes, our coaches, and Shocker Nation. Those aren't words on a wall, guys. We talk about that every single day. Those are lenses through which we make decisions. We're here to develop young people and programs. So the role is to remove obstacles for our young people to pursue their education, to pursue their goals and dreams from an athletics perspective, with specificity to Coach Mills, his staff, and men's basketball. Our goal is to remove obstacles, and there are plenty. Every institution has them, and we work at that every single day. One of the significant challenges for everybody across the industry and the landscape is obviously NIL and the transfer portal, and so we're going to work hard every day at raising the resources, at working very closely with the collectives, formerly Armchair. Armchair has merged with Blueprint Sports. It is now rebranded the Wheat Shot Collective. We do that for very specific reasons. Blueprint Sports is currently hiring a general manager, which will be a full-time position, could potentially be housed within athletics, but would be a Blueprint Sports employee. Full-time GM that's focused solely on NIL at Wichita State. So that's the events. That's the drive for 5,000 folks at $500 a year. That's the communication, the publication, the social media. By doing those things, we're trying to remove obstacles for Coach Mills and his staff.
so that they can not only recruit but retain elite level talent that will enable us to win championships. And at the end of the day, that's where we're all united, is we want to win championships. We want to do it the right way. And we've got an incredibly complex and somewhat nuanced landscape in which to do that. And that's our role administratively.
$5,000 for $500 a year. It's probably a little more comfortable for me to say it than you guys, but there are certainly avenues and assets in this community before that have been much larger supporters than that. And that's a big piece of it too, for all those folks out there listening. Kind of a fun one here, Coach, for you, as we are beginning to wind this down. I envision this transfer portal as like this fun buffet of just players all over the place. I have no idea how you guys try to digest all of this, between, you know, junior college players. There's a ton of them right now, and Hutch playing, you know, a massive, awesome, fun tournament, to Division II players, which we know have made the transition to Division high level player. Like, how on earth do you guys navigate so many different avenues of players to try and see like what fits? I cannot envision the appropriate amount of time to do that. Do we have you, Coach? Okay, we may have lost a connection there, Jad. So that's okay. That's all right. But we're about out of time anyway. So, well, I think we've got a bad connection there. So that's fine. That's all right. It sounds like we're catching a little bit. So this was a lot of fun. We got to do this again. We need to do this again as we make our way through this off season, because it's really just getting started, I think. But there are so many players out there. And just to sort of recap and bring this back, if you want more on the NIL specific stuff, there is a podcast out right now with Kevin there and Paul Sullentrop on the Roundhouse podcast that they do. You can find that on the Odyssey app, which is, you know, our family of stations. There's an app, everything's there. The other thing you can do if you're joining us late to this is you can go find this interview on the Odyssey app. You can go back and listen to that as we podcast out Sports Daily every day and get some of that. A lot of really good and interesting insight there, I think, into the processes of things. I am fascinated by the fact that, you know, there is open communication. Of course there is. Of course there's open communication with players throughout a season. I love that that's happening, quite frankly, because people sometimes, I think, we overthink all of this. Like, it's this space that exists that doesn't operate like the rest of us operate every single day. And of course we do, right? Like, we all know what our future looks like, and probably our bosses know what our future looks like. There's always communication about that kind of stuff. Nobody's going to be blindsided by anything that happens, for the most part. It's great stuff. You can go back and listen to it on the Odyssey app. You can catch that Roundhouse podcast on more of the NIL. And Kevin just cracked the lid a little bit. We'll get more on this about the evolving structure of the NIL stuff. So we'll do that, but we'll take a quick break. We've got Wichita State baseball coming up later this hour, so we're going to take a break. We'll come back. We'll have just a little bit more, and then we'll actually bring in Mike Kennedy as sort of a brief pregame show into a Shocker baseball broadcast that begins at 10:45 here for you. So I know it's a jam-packed second hour. We'll do more of this as we make our way through the offseason. Albracht and Castor Sports Daily coming right back. All right, welcome back into Sports Daily, everybody. Jacob Albracht, Tommy Castor. Great conversation there with Kevin Saul, Wichita State Athletic Director, Paul Mills, Wichita State Men's Basketball Coach. You can go back on the Odyssey app, find that conversation. You can also find a more in-depth conversation on the state of NIL on the Roundhouse podcast. All of it's available for you on the Odyssey app, so check that out. We'll have to do that again. I knew it was going to be tough to cram everything in there, and we just run out of time on something like that, but man, that's good stuff. So check it out if you missed it, and then you know we'll do that again this offseason, sort of get a state of things as we move forward. Programming note here in just a little bit. This is our last segment now because we're going to have Wichita State baseball against Rice. Mike Kennedy will join us in a few minutes to sort of get a little teaser on that. Then we'll hand the keys to him to finish up the hour. Sweet 16 coming tonight. There's all kinds of things happening right now in the sports world. It's hard. I don't recall, and this has to always happen, Tommy, where we get this collision of opening day with March Madness. It feels to me, though, like baseball may be starting a bit earlier than normal. I'm not sure that typically happens. It almost feels like there's a transitional point, but I'm glad that it is because it allows us more wiggle room in the Major League Baseball schedule for some doubleheaders and things when there's rainouts and things like that. So it makes sense. But it's all March Madness right now. Like it's all March Madness. That conversation we just had, I'm starved for Wichita State to be back there. I mean, I just am ready for them to be back in that spotlight every single year. And you know, progress at the end of the year on the court, it will be fascinating. Wichita State's a great landing spot, don't you think?
Yeah.
Colby Rogers is out.
Yeah.
Coach mentioned shots. There are shots available.
Yeah, and the thing that was really eye-opening to me, I think, in that interview is, and it goes back to what you mentioned before the break about how a lot of these decisions are being made well ahead of time about who's leaving, who's coming back, you know, that sort of thing. But that's not what the public knows. You know, the public knows that, you know, when it's announced that a player is entering the portal, that's when everybody finds out about it. And so, you know, I ask Coach Mills the question about does it stunt the momentum? Not even thinking that these are conversations that maybe have been taking place for weeks or even months ahead of time. And so, you know, no, it doesn't. And so I think that does, you know, allow you to kind of peek behind the curtain a little bit, and that these things are in some cases, maybe not always, but in some cases scripted, planned out. Everybody kind of knows what the future is going to look like, you know, for their program and their individual careers moving forward.
Yeah. It's, it is just, it's real. And again, that's refreshing for me to hear. And honestly, I think it's probably a credit knowing that to the teams where it's 100% obvious that everyone's bought in and working their tails off. That would be the case, I think, far more often than otherwise. And this will all be a little bit less chaotic if everybody can just embrace the reality of it. Nobody likes surprises there in that space. But again, you can go back and listen to that anytime you'd like. Let's bring in Mike Kennedy here for a couple of minutes. He'll have the call of Wichita State and Rice baseball. We haven't talked a ton of Shocker baseball yet, Mike, because we're still navigating our way through the end of the basketball season. Shocker baseball, I have to imagine, and you have watched more of it than anybody on the planet, you know, in for a long time. What is your take on this specific team, and how good might they be in this American Athletic Conference race?
Well, I think the first thing is nobody knew quite what to expect going into this season. It is a totally rebuilt roster. There are 11 guys back who are on last year's team, and really about half of those played any kind of significant role last year, a brand new coaching staff. And so really hard to know what to expect. And they were picked 7th out of 10 teams in the preseason conference poll. And this team has just been much better already than I think anybody had any right to expect. They've done a great job with this team. The guys that have returned have gotten better. And they brought in kind of an uncharacteristic recruiting class for this time. You were just talking about NIL and all that stuff. This is primarily a group of freshmen and junior college transfers. And Pete Hughes from Kansas State said something to Brian Green before their game a week ago when he said, you know, you've rebuilt in the old-fashioned way. You're almost setting a new model here, and what a great job you've done. So I think that's been the biggest thing, is just it's turned into a lot more this soon than I think anybody might have expected.
Yeah, Mike, to your point on that, I think going into the season, after knowing the way that the recruiting class was put together, and the newcomers and all of that, I don't know if I really necessarily had a huge question about if it would work. I thought that there would be a level of success. I just wasn't sure how soon that would happen. And it seems like out of the gate, Brian Green has been able to get these returners and the newcomers to be able to, you know, come together and piece together a lineup and a rotation and all of that, that has basically worked for the most part out of the gate.
The big question marks, I think, were more detail type things. When they went through the fall, I think they felt like, you know, we've got some guys that can hit. But Brian mentioned to me right before the season opener, he said, the thing I don't know is who goes where. I mean, no, I don't have a clear idea of who's the leadoff guy, who's the three hole, who's the cleanup man. Or the same way they'd identified Caden Favors as their Friday guy, but the starting rotation was still a little bit of a question mark. And then how do all these other guys fit in the bullpen? I don't think anybody off of Nate Adler's two previous seasons at Wichita State would have pictured him being the closer, and here he is with 5 saves and a 0-point-something ERA up among the leaders in the country. So that's been the thing that's really come together, and I think part of that is just stressing the emphasis on certain types of fundamentals, and the guys have really listened and really bought into what this coaching staff is telling them.
Mike, I want to switch just a second to basketball and ask your take on this tournament as it's played out. I don't know how much time you've had to consume it. I assume plenty. What do you think of this grouping in the Sweet 16? And I guess now it's down a little bit further than that, but who do you like? And is anybody going to beat UConn? Are you embracing UConn as the villain the rest of, you know, a lot of America is?
Well, going in, I had my bracket has Houston beating UConn in the championship game. Okay. And I felt that way, even though Houston got drummed in the Big 12 tournament championship. So that part hasn't surprised me. I guess the thing that's been a little surprising is there's just a few more of the high seeds. All the ones and twos were still left going into the Sweet 16, and that hasn't happened for a while. But I didn't pick a lot of upsets on my bracket, and so I guess it hasn't been a big surprise to me the way it's kind of played out.
Well, we're looking forward to that. We're looking forward to the call. We'll see if the Shockers can maybe sweep Rice. I think that would be a really nice thing to have happen here. Mike's got the call in just a few minutes, and Mike, just can't tell you how much we're glad to have you on there, back on the air after a brief time away. Hope everything's going well and you're feeling well. And it's baseball season, softball season. It is that time of year. Glad to have you. Mike will have the call in just a second.
Thank you, guys.
We're going to hand the keys off to Mike. Look, just take you through the programming lineup for the weekend here as we've got about a minute left. So you've got that call today, 10:45. Mike will have it in just a few minutes against Rice. The last game of that series, remember, it's Easter weekend, so they'll wrap the series on Saturday, is 11:45 for a noon start against Rice. Then you get the Royals back in action after that at 3 o'clock against the Twins on KFH. And then on Sunday, Easter Sunday, you will have Royals baseball here on KFH. That game begins at 1 o'clock. So that's your programming. Hey, go check out the Odyssey app for a conversation with Kevin Saul and Paul Mills. And more information in the Roundhouse podcast about the NIL space. Great week, everybody. Thanks for being here with us. For Jad and Tommy, I'm Jacob. Wichita State baseball is next.